Wisconsin, and they got a...
Where did you get your bachelor's degree?
I forgot, it was so long ago.
Yeah.
Biology.
In biology, where?
University of Wisconsin, Whitewater.
Okay. University of Wisconsin.
Got Whitewater.
Got Whitewater. And then he got a master's degree in Nebraska. And then a PhD in plant pathology at UT. Plant pathology, entomology, and nematology at the University of Tennessee. And he started a second career because his first career he retired already. And he worked for the CIA. And he has a very interesting job, his first one. But I think is more excited about a second job, and that's working with nematodes and millipedes. So today he's going to tell us about what he's been finding in millipedes.
So before I start, you all have the right to remain silent. Mm-hmm. Anything you say will be used against you. Now, I was actually in law enforcement, but attached to the embassy. And I thought, you know, when I retired, will I still have the same excitement and adrenaline and passion to do something as my former career, chasing guys down who were involved in terrorism or drug trafficking or crimes against children, money laundering or dirty bombs or whatever? And then I met Dr. Bernard, and he told me about this project that he always wanted to do for his whole career, but really didn't have the time to do it. And that was to look at the biodiversity of life inside arthropods, and such a simple arthropod, millipede. And I first thought, okay, I'll do anything, because I love science, I've always loved science. And the passion that was ignited in me on the first day that I actually opened up the intestine of a millipede was just pure excitement. And that first time finding a brand new species that no one has ever found was exhilarating. It was equated to arresting the most heinous guy that I ever, you know, tracked down in my 23 years in law enforcement. So today, I'm just going to talk a few minutes first about organisms that parasitize or are commensal to millipedes. And then the majority of my talk would be specifically about nematodes that are commensal to millipedes. And in case you're wondering, the circles, these are forid flies that are ovipositing in between the segments. And they, forids will basically eat the inside out of this millipede. And I have a picture that Dr. Bernard did from just a few days ago. So the objectives of our research in our lab basically, it's just to examine the relationship between the organisms that are inside the guts of millipedes. And we're trying to conduct a complete taxonomic analysis of everything that we find when it pertains to the nematodes. And we do annotate other organisms, of course, that we find. And we're going to be describing nematodes. A lot of the nematodes that have been described in the past need serious revision. There were some very scant drawings of certain species, so we have to look at that more thoroughly, both anatomically and molecularly. And of course, the thing that really excited me, and you'll see in a future slide, but the identification of new species. And if you're a budding taxonomist, this is a wide open area. No one has really ever done any work on millipedes and the commensal relationships of other organisms. And you'd be amazed how many new species that we found. If Dr. Bernard and I stop right now, we could write seriously every day for the next 5 years and still not get caught up. That's how many we found. And I'm not exaggerating. And then we're just to take a real quick look at the population dynamics of the nematodes inside the gut. And I think when you see some of the numbers, very generalized statistics, how many we found, you may be surprised. Maybe not, but we'll see. So how did all this research get started? Does anyone by chance, without looking at the name, know who he is? The last man that knew everything? Joseph Leidy? He was a medical doctor, but he was a kind of a generalist in a little of everything. he actually was the first to start looking at the diversity of life inside the millipede gut. And he did this around 1849. And what kind of amazed me as a student working for Dr. Bernard, when we would go into taxonomy class for entomology, we had these old 1970 Leica microscopes, and we all complained that we couldn't see nothing. And then I look at his microscope, and he drew these fantastic drawings with that, you know, 150-year-old microscope. So what you see here is one of his original plates, and this is actually one of the nematodes. This is called, he called it Streptosoma, but it's actually called Aureus now. And this is a Rhigonema. This is the epidermis of the gut. And what you see here, these holdfasts, these are trichomycetes, and attached to that is bacteria and ciliated protists. And all of this we also see, and I'll show you some real pictures here momentarily. Whoops, here. So I should have said as a caveat, I'm old school. Clickers, computers, anything electronic, I have a rough time with, so I apologize for that. My daughter does all the electronics for me. But anyway, this here is a Rhigonema nematode covered in trichomycetes, and it's a fungus. And they get, some of these nematodes get so engulfed in these trichomycetes, they can barely move. And we thought that was really a cool picture, so we wanted to at least show you some of the things that we see. And this is a scanning electron microscopic image of the trichomycete on the anterior end of the nematode. Then we frequently see in quite a few dissections ciliated protists. This isn't the protist that we actually get from the gut. I couldn't find a really good picture that we could take that would show it better than this, but it's related. And then we find nematodes quite frequently, well, not frequently, but quite often with this bacillus bacteria just covering the body. So we also find a different phylum of life inside the gut, acanthocephalans, thorny-headed worms, and they're pretty interesting critters. When I first saw one, I took parasitology years and years ago, 30-some years ago in Wisconsin, and I remember working on a parasite called Acanthocephala parasitii that we found in fish. But I didn't really realize that you could also find them in millipedes. And when we looked at it, Dr. Bernard actually identified it. He could see the head end, the thorny end, quite clearly. So basically, the reason I put this slide in here is there was an interesting story of an 18-month-old girl who ingested a millipede out of Florida. And what happened, the doctors think she ingested a millipede, and it grew into from the acanthor to the infective stage, the cysticanth, and then she passed the adult. And they couldn't figure out what was wrong with her, and it was basically because she consumed that intermediate host. Other hosts of this is called Macroacanthorhynchus ingens, are the intermediate hosts are scarab beetles, roaches, millipedes, and then like pigs or raccoons that feed on them, they become the final host, the definitive host, and they usually are found in those critters. But there are cases where humans have got the acanthocephalans. So these are gregarines. We see these quite often in the mid and foregut. When we open them up, they're just protists. But just a few weeks ago, we were amazed and shocked that we found living mites from the genus Schwebia living inside the hindgut of the millipedes. And we've never really seen that. Well, actually, I saw it once before, but I convinced myself that that wasn't a mite. There's no way that could be a mite. So this last round, Dr. Bernard and I went to Alabama. We collected about 100 millipedes called Choctella euricti, and we started to notice all these phoretic mites. And then when we started opening them up, the intestine, they were just packed with mites, several dozen mites. So when I saw it, I went back to Dr. Bernard, because I still didn't believe it, and he looked at them, and for sure they were mites. So then I just happened to, I figured, I'm just going to SEM one, and this is one of the better pictures that we found. So we've sent these to Barry O'Connor in Michigan to do some studies on it, but we haven't found any literature suggesting that these are, they consume mites. I think it's accidental or random, but it's pretty interesting to us, so we couldn't dismiss it. So this is the last one I'll talk about. These are forids, and as you can see here, this forid is ovipositing in between the antennal segment. And the reason they usually, millipedes put off this defensive chemical, they're either benzoquinones or terpenoids or terpenes or hydrogen cyanide, and they're actually supposed to detract predators. But in this case, as they secrete these type of chemicals, the benzoquinones, the forid fly is attracted to that. And they oviposit, and they basically, when the eggs develop and go into the hemocoel, the forids, the larva, eats the inside of the millipede out. So just maybe 2 or 3 weeks ago, Dr. Bernard found a dead Narcissus americanus in our enclosure that we got from Alabama. And we put it in alcohol, and basically it was the reason we put it in alcohol because we wanted to see how the millipedes or the nematodes would look, you know, taking them out of alcohol and dissecting them out of the intestine. But he found nematodes, but he also found a bunch of forid larvae. I think he found maybe 2 or 3 dozen, Dr. Bernard.
Yeah.
And this is just a picture from our dissecting scope. So it's just packed with forid larvae. So that's kind of the diversity of what we see excluding nematodes in the intestine of millipedes. So oftentimes what we do, and here's kind of what we do and how it's done. Thus far, in the 4 or 5 years that I've been with Dr. Bernard, we've dissected 1,170 millipedes, and they have to be, generally, we like them alive when we dissect them, because then the nematodes are much easier to identify. And they span about 6 orders. There's 10 orders in North America, and we've covered about 18 families and 61 species of millipedes so far. We've actually traveled to all 21 states that are colored here. The only state that we got skunked, that I spent 3 weeks in Nevada at the Great Basin, you know, we had to try. I mean, there's desert millipedes called orthopurus or natives that live in the desert, but we had no luck in Nevada. But all these other states produced millipedes that also produce nematodes. So far, I just did the numbers about a week and a half ago. We've extracted over 78,000 nematodes, and I'll show you a bit of a video on how we do that, which encompasses 9 families of nematodes. And there's the number right now, and I've lost count. We've got over 24 at least, the very least, new species. So we have just a tremendous amount of work that we have to do to identify or to describe these things. So what we do is we go out and we collect, then we have the hard part. I thought identifying nematodes was hard. Identifying millipedes is equally as hard as Jackson probably knows, because you have to look at the gonopods and you really have to become an expert. And there's only 6 of you guys in the United States that work on millipedes and describing millipedes. So we dissected intestine out. We basically cut the head off. We cut the epiproct off. Use fine tip forceps, pull the intestine out. And then I start from the posterior end, and Dr. Bernard starts at the anterior end. We just peel it apart little by little. And as we peel it apart, the nematodes start coming out. We then have to separate them into groups, usually family groups. That can take quite a bit of time. Then we segregate some of those for molecular analysis, for SEM, and then for long-term preservation, and then for morphological examination. So here's what we see when we do this, and this is only 30 seconds long, but what this is, these are Phillipsoma nematodes. They're a little shaky, I don't know why, but all this other stuff is gut contact, food particles, sometimes you see sand and dirt and debris. And when you have 2 2,327 of these guys squiggling around. It takes us 2 days, two of us working together, just to separate them and try and put them into families. And then we got to figure out what they are from there. So one dissection can take from start to finish, including the actual dissection, about a week. And we have to put them on slides and SEM and molecular. It's a very lengthy process. So here is basically on the y-axis, we have the number of millipedes that we've dissected that has zero nematodes. So 293 of the millipedes that we dissected didn't have anything. But then we have 572 millipedes that had a range of 1 to 50 nematodes in the gut. And then you have, we separated this, the last 25% out, as you can see down here. Although we love seeing this, it's exciting for the first hour, but after the ninth or tenth hour, you're like, when are we gonna get done? But, and this number is, really is when we basically decided to stop. We could keep going and going and going because some of them are just so small that it almost gets impossible to count them. So our next pie chart here, what this basically is out of the 10 orders of millipedes that are in the United States, we've collected six. And what we found so far, the platydesmata and the julida, they're really kind of small millipedes. The width and the length and the weight are very nominal. And what we found so far, doing some statistical analysis, in general, a millipede with a 2 millimeter or less diameter usually does not have nematodes. But the guys who are bigger than 2 millimeters in diameter, such as the Calipoda, we have found has only averaged to just maybe 4 nematodes in the gut on, in each one that we dissect. And what's interesting about this particular group, there's only one species that we find. It's called Thelostoma. But we don't find it in anything else. It's just in this particular, this is called it Vaison magnum. So then the next one, this is Archaeospirus streptozygous. It's the world's largest millipede. It's about 270 millimeters long, 80 grams, and about 15 millimeters wide. This is the one that takes us, you know, a week to do. But this one only had, believe it or not, only had 35 on average this order. There's many other nematodes in this order, which brings this number down. Because we've dissected several hundred of this in order, and we've only dissected maybe six of these guys so far. So it brings it down a little bit. And then we have the polydesmata. These are these really brightly colored. They emit hydrogen cyanide. They have a bunch, a little higher, 37 nematodes is the mean. And then we have the spirobolids, which are the common ones you guys probably see around here, the big cylindrical ones called Narcea americanus. They on average have about 183 nematodes. So there's lots of nematodes in these things, and there's a lot of different species that no one has ever described. So if you have a student or a graduate student who needs a project, there's more than enough to go around, believe me. We've got 4 more orders to examine in the United States that we haven't even touched. And then we have 6 orders after that throughout the world. Because there's 60 orders of millipedes. So a little bit about nematode taxonomy. In the group that we work, the invertebrate nematodes that we examine, there's 2 inferorders, Rhigonematomorpha, and these are exclusive to millipedes only. And then we have Oxyuridomorpha, which they can be found in millipedes, they can be found in insects, and I've even found some papers where they've been found in turtles and lizards. So then we have these 2 oddballs that we couldn't place in either group. We have no idea what they are. This is the mouth that's everted, and you see these little stringy things. We think maybe they help collect bacteria when they're eating because they're this group here, they're all bacterial feeders. But then we come to this guy. It's called Conmostoma clare, and this one is different than all the others, because it doesn't feed on bacteria. It actually feeds on other nematodes, which this is kind of my favorite group because it's the predator in the gut of the other nematodes. And they're very rare. It's very difficult to find them. But when we find them, we're really excited. At least I am. So I'm going to talk just a few minutes about Conmostoma, just to give you a historical background of what they're about. So in 1958, they were found in Anwar Pradesh, India. And from 1958 to about 2006-ish, there were only six species described throughout the world. So in that 50 years, they've only found six species. Of those species, in Brazil, Burkina Faso, the Congo, Madagascar, and Australia, these were all from millipedes here. I'm excluding Tanzania for a moment, and I'll tell you why. The Conmostoma from Australia was from a roach, which was a bit unusual, but that's pretty cool for us. But 50 years goes by, only six species. So then we start our project, and they're only found in tropical areas. So then we start our project. We go to Florida in 2014, 2015, and we pick up a millipede called Narcissus gordanus, and we found Conmostoma in mid-Florida. And that was really exciting for us because no one has ever described this nematode from the North America. So then, as our research progresses, I go to my dad's backyard, literally my dad's backyard, dissect a millipede called Aphaloria montana, and it's very common in the Appalachians. Caught him open, got a second species of Conmostoma, which we're in the process of describing. And then Dr. Bernard and I go to Alabama, and someone sent us one from Mississippi, another species of Conmostoma, much different, and this is what they look like. So this is the one we actually got published a couple years ago. It's named after my daughter because she found the millipede. I dragged her out. If you guys, you guys are over 50, who can't see anymore or can't walk or whatever, I need my daughter's eyes to spot these things because you got to go out in the middle of the night between, for us, between 10 and 3 a.m. She was not happy with me, but she went out and she found them for me. I picked them up because she won't handle them. Brought them back, dissected them, so we named it after my daughter, Claire. And what's interesting about this guy, the reason we know it's nematophagous, bacterial fetals have a grinding valve right here, and I should have shown you that earlier. These don't have a grinding valve. And Dr. Bernard and I actually found the remnants of a nematode in the gut on one of our slides. So this one is from Florida and Alabama. And then we found this guy out of Mississippi. And morphologically, or anatomically, you can see this is the first annual. It only reaches about the third of the way here. And I'm just giving you one character of this corpus area. But this guy, its annual extends past the isthmus here. And this one has a completely different shape. Molecularly, they're all different. So we're in the process of, you know, doing all that work as well. I haven't forgotten about the molecular work. So then I'm going to go to a second millipede. This is a very interesting millipede because it's a one-of-a-kind millipede. It only has one family. It's called Choctelidae. It's only found in two areas of the world, and we're lucky enough to live in one of those areas in Tennessee. And then we're only a few hours from the second place that it lives in Alabama. And I, because I'm kind of a, I transitioned from law enforcement into science, and I'm still relatively new to academia, I got tricked. I tricked myself by relying on color patterns, thinking that, oh, Choctella commensi is ubricti, and ubricti is commensi, or vice versa, because these color variations vary tremendously. The only way to definitively know what species you have is you have to look at the gonopods. And these are SEM images of the gonopods. So I think Jackson can appreciate the difficulty sometime in trying to dissect these things out. But yeah, so this is Choctella. So here's where it lives. And the Choctella commensi only lives in the Nashville area around Cedar of Lebanon State Park and Radnor State Park, in some selected areas south of there. So Dr. Bernard and I got the idea, let's go south of the Tennessee River, thinking that the nematode fauna will be different, or will it be the same Will there be nematodes in the sister species here, Eurypti? So we went to Oak Mountain and we got about 100 of these, and we had 100 of these, and we found definitely different nematodes in each. In the one in Nashville, we only found one species, this guy here. The one in Birmingham, Alabama, we found two, maybe three different species. So it's a little more diverse down in Alabama versus Nashville. We really don't know why, but they are. But you can see the differences here. The head ends are a little bit different. These project upwards. We don't have these structures as prominent here as in the Eurypti. So the next nematode I want to talk about is a nematode that is unique because the only place we ever see it is in the family Zistodesmidae, this type of millipede. Zistodesmids are usually very easily identifiable by these unique lateral projections called paranoda. We've dissected almost 400 Zistodesmids, and the only place that this particular nematode, Stantoractomn shellii, exists are in this group of millipedes. Other Zistodesmids don't have these Stantoractomn. It's only the Zistodesmids. I'm sorry, other millipedes outside of that family, but within that order. So this is what it looks like under the DIC scope. You can see this really, we called it for a long time mushroom head, because that's what it looks like under the scope. We have all kind of weird names for these, because no one has ever seen these things. So we got to kind of put a name on them when you're doing your data. So it was mushroom head, and you can see why. These are, it's almost like a false annual, where these are, there's eight of these, and they're constricted. And because there's eight, one of the defining characters of this thelostomatic group are they have eight cephalic papillae. And we think these maybe correlate to that. See this big opening down here, and then you can see it on the DIC. That's called the excretory pore. And I've never seen the excretory pore in SEM before. We were lucky enough to get it at the right angle, and we got a pretty good shot at it. We named this after one of the millipede experts in the U.S. called, by the name of Dr. Roland Shelley. He helped us a lot on identifying the millipedes, so we gave him a patronym for it. So the next group I want to talk about is Heth. Heth is a really unique species, because again, they're only found in the tropical areas. There's 49 species in all. As you can see, when I said there's a wealth of opportunity, you can see all of this no one has ever looked at. Even here is basically vacant. You know, Western South America and Southern South America is vacant. If you look, you will find, when I was in law enforcement, everyone would ask me, you think we should do a search warrant? I said, well, if you don't look, you'll never find anything. And that's the same with new species. So back in a couple years ago, Dr. Ramon Carreno out of Ohio Wesleyan, I think it was in 2006, he went to the Keys. And he was looking at the introduced millipede, Rhinocricus. It's a Rhinocricus, a Rhinocricidae. Manila cornus is the species. Well, right, what is that? Rhinocricus or Manila cornus? Is that right?
Sounds right to me.
Yeah. But anyway, what he found when he dissected it is it's introduced to the U.S. from the Caribbean. He found this called Hathmarisii. And as you can see, the difference here is they have all these cuticular spines, they have this collar, they have this giant pseudolabial head that opens up and has these fringes in it. I'll show you a better picture in a moment. And the neck swivels like two to three times a second as it's raking back and forth for bacteria. So what we did again in Florida, this is called Narcissus organus. It's one of the biggest millipedes in the U.S. Then we also found a millipede called Florida bolus. So these are in the Ocala National Forest, and you guys can go down there and literally pick them up at night and find probably different species in these guys. But we found this guy. This is the first half ever recorded out of North America that's not introduced. It's from an indigenous millipede. Narcissus gordiana is indigenous to the United States. So this is almost the article is almost finished. We're also doing a worldwide key to HEF, so it makes it a little easier for people to identify. And you can see this big pseudolabium, this hole here is called the amphid. It's a chemosensory structure. And then this particular collar, lateral spines. And there's a good image of the neck, how it folds back and forth. Females are very ornate. The males, like a lot of males, are very boring. Not much going on in the male. So we use the females in most nematodes to identify the genus and species. So maybe a couple years ago, Dr. Renard and I were talking about when I was going to write my dissertation. He said it'd be a really good idea to include a teaching tractor, because there's a lot of kids out there that live in urban areas that have no access to even a butterfly, they can maybe find a roach or something, but we have to come up with a way to try and introduce more kids and their teachers to other things other than cuddly bears and things like that. Arthropods are really important and they're neglected. So we came up with this idea, mostly Dr. Bernard, to come up with a way where we could show kids how to dissect a millipede very easily with their teacher, and then use us in collaboration to maybe identify new species. So we did that. But before we did that, we wanted to see, what if they can't go out and find a millipede? So how about Carolina biologicals or Fisher or someone like that? If they buy them for a few dollars, this guy doesn't cost $5. But there are nematodes or millipedes such as Narcissus that cost like $5. And what if you could buy a millipede, take it into the classroom, it's already identified, and dissect it and have the opportunity and a good probability of actually finding a new species. That would be such a good idea for kids, that it'd get them hooked on nematodes and arthropods in general. And what a great line on your CV or your resume saying you were involved in a new species while you're in high school. And so Dr. Renard just a couple months ago did this exact thing with kids that are homeschooling.
Well, you did too.
Yeah, well.
We both did.
Yeah. And they went crazy. We thought no way we can keep these kids entertained for 4 hours. They didn't want to leave. They were dissecting and playing, and they just wouldn't leave them alone. It was great. But anyway, so we bought Archaeospira streptozygus, the biggest nematode in the world. And what we did is we dissected this guy, and we started to find more species that's never been described before. And these are just some brief examples of some that we found. This is called Brumptomilius, and this is the female, and you can see it's got a very distinctive corpus and basal bulb and the esophageal region. And the male is a lot different. Usually, it's easier to distinguish species through the females, but in this particular group, it's the males that you need more morphological characters to separate the species. Males have an area called the area rugosa. It's on the posterior end near the tail, and it's really roughened. And I'll show you a photo. And we use that to kind of figure out which group we're working with. So what we see here, this is the first species of Brumptomilius that we found when we start dissecting Archaeospira streptus. And let me just point out a few things. This is the area rugosa, which defines kind of the group. If this structure was smooth, we know, okay, it could be another species called genus called Werbeckia, but it's rough. These are the caudal papillae, and this is the cloaca, and this is the tail. This thing here is called the spicule, and that's used in mating to open up the vulva. And this little structure down here is called the gubernaculum. It's just a guiding ring for the spicule when it is inserted into the vulva. This thing here, this is a male, as you can see, but all these little thingies here are called supplements. There's like 50 of them. There's a tremendous amount of these things, and we don't know why there's so many. And when we SEM'd it,
they kind of look like this, and we were kind of, you know, quite pleased with the SEM, but when we blew it up a little, we see their digit form, and these are actually used to help separate the species. There's 21 species of Rhomphomimilius, but 11 of them are in Clarinda, and they're all from, mostly from Africa. So this whole group needs to be redone, and we're trying to do that very slowly. It's going to take years for us to get to all of this. So as we're looking more and more into the nematode fauna, then we found a second species of Rhomphomimilius. By the way, going through the literature, we've not found any of these in the literature so far. Dr. Bernard had this idea to roll the body, and instead of two rows of supplements, we found four rows. And when we took a lateral profile of the supplements, they had 5 to 7 of these digitform processes. Then when we looked at the spicule even looks much different than the other spicule. As you can see, it's a corkscrew type of structure that it twists around each other. So we also use that as a morphological character to separate the species. Now the females are much more difficult to identify. They have a very distinctive esophageal region, they do have spines, and they have these really crazy anthids. For nematologists, this is kind of exciting because an anthid is really big and it's very unique compared to other nematodes. But the problem that we have, how do we know that, among many, how do we know which male goes with this female? And there's other species of females in here. We can barely tell the females apart. We got to do molecular, of course, but morphologically, when you're in there, it's really difficult to tell these things apart. So here's yet another probably 3 to 5 year project just trying to figure all that out. Then I go back to Conmostoma. So that one millipede, we find 3 more species of Conmostoma. So in the 50 years that it took other researchers to find 6 species, in just a few years, 1/10 the time essentially, we've equaled the number of species just by looking where no one else looks. And that to us is really exciting. These are all in the queue to be identified. And we just got another one out of a millipede called Uriuris. And so we're up to 7 now. Now we've surpassed that already. I can show you here. These things here, these are really cool. These are anthids. There's only three groups of nematodes that have these projections. And they're pretty neat. They're very distinctive. But out of that 78,000 nematodes that we extracted, we've only found 6 male Conmostomas. They're extremely rare. And the gut-wrenching decision you make is, okay, 1 SEM, 1 to molecular, maybe 2, because my molecular skills aren't the best. And then the rest permanent mounts. But we generally like to have 10 of these for our measurements, at least 10. Many times we do up to 50 or 60 because I'm a little bit OCD. But this is the SEM image of the head. This is the genital cone area of the male. This kind of looks like Miss Piggy, if you use your imagination. And these are just some little spikes on the tail, which we use to identify our Conmostoma males. And then we have this really crazy one called Volovaginema. There's only one species that's been identified so far in the world. It's called Volovaginema aspiculatum. Aspiculatum means without a spicule. And right away, when Dr. Bernard and I looked at the male, it had a spicule, so we know we had a new species right off the bat, so we're all jumping up and down. SEM image of the male is not very good, but that's the best I could get at the time. Same with the female. Female's very distinctive. It has these 3 little ridges here, or bumps. All of it is really long and soft, it's long. The business of the basal bulb. And then we saw these things. These are the juveniles, the J3 stage of the male and female. We did this through molecular work. But as you can see, it looks like predatory, doesn't it? It looks like the alien out of that movie, The Alien? That popped out of your stomach?
Oh, yeah.
What is that? Whatever it was?
Yeah.
Okay.
Or predator.
I don't watch it on there because this is actually the ventral side. This is the dorsal side. When I first looked at it, I said, are you sure, Dr. Bernard? And he said, where's the excretory port and where's the anus? And I'm like, okay. You can see I'm still new. So then we thought, okay, I'm going to go SEM this thing and see what it looks like. And that's what it looked like.
Ugh, wow.
Isn't that crazy? It looks just like that thing out of the Alien. But this is a lateral shot. This is a lateral line, a lateral field. This is looking straight down the mouth. It was a pretty impressive nematode for a third stage juvenile. So then very quickly, the ones that I showed you, the live shots, that's these. These are thelastoma. This is a male. This is the first time it's ever been reported of a spermatophore being found in this genus of nematode called thelastoma. So we're quite happy with that. This is what the sperm looks like under DIC. So the last thing I want to show you, because I want to make sure I'm right on time, is this is my attempt at molecular work. And having this as a second career, I'm 30 years behind you guys. You know, when I was 20 years old, I was doing the AFLP and EchoR1 restriction enzyme. You guys remember that? And now you guys are so far advanced, so this is my attempt to try and catch up to you all. But here's where they fall out. This is the oxyuridomorpha, the rhigonematomorpha group here. And these are the oxyuridomorpha group. This is half that I showed you here that aligns down here. And we have protostoma, stratostoma, and these two from Tennessee and Alabama. And this weird one that we didn't know which infraorder it belonged. The molecular evidence suggests it's in the thelastomoidea or the oxyuridomorpha group. And with that, I would just like to thank Dr. Shelley, who helped us with a lot of identifications, Dr. Wolin, Dr. Pachula, Dr. Eisenbeck, of course, for inviting us, Rob Pivar, Rod Sinari, my wife, and my daughter. And do you have any questions? My daughter did that, and I always use that. That's a really good question. We were just engaged in that discussion before we came here. We really don't know. That ornamentation is really unique among the females. Almost every female of all 49 species has that ornamentation except for maybe one. And all the males don't have that. And one of my thoughts was, and Dr. Eisenbart brought this up, he goes, well, why wouldn't the males feed? They're robust. They're certain. Dr. Bernard then said, well, they're really big. You know, why aren't they feed? Why wouldn't they feed? So the answer is, I really don't know. I wish I could tell you why that is, but it's a good question, and we've pondered that for the last couple of years. As far as the ornamentation, I thought to myself a couple times, maybe it is used to anchor themselves when they're raking back and forth for bacteria, if they orientate themselves in the anterior direction. But I'm not sure. I don't think anyone's really looked at that.
In your phylogeny, that was a nice evolutionary reconstruction. Do those clades correspond to groups of millipedes, monophyletic groups of millipedes?
That's another thing that I need to, that's on my list to do. And I've just started doing molecular work on the millipedes, and I often thought of trying to do some type of overlay type of analysis, but I haven't gotten to that yet. That is on one of our lists to do, and I'm probably going to have to collaborate with someone to help with something like that, but that is something that we're looking about doing, but we haven't got to it yet. Yes, sir.
Sorry, maybe I missed. How did you infer that philosophy?
What's that?
How do you infer your philosophy?
Well, we basically just, did it the traditional way where we just used the 228S and 18S, and we separate them out like that and just put them in, I can't remember which program we use, Mr. Bayes and the typical programs.
Thank you. You can identify millipedes, but just identifying the nematodes.
So far in some of them, we only find certain nematodes and certain millipedes, so we can narrow it eventually narrowed it down. Like Calipota, that Abaceae magnum, and the one Choctella, there's only one millipede in there, or one nematode in that millipede, so that's a possibility. But I haven't really tried it. Yes, sir.
I don't know anything about nematodes, but you mentioned that some of them eat fetal bacteria. Do you know what, if some of them are parasitic to the
That's a really good question. We first thought, or we were suggesting that they were kleptoparasitic, where they would be inside the gut, and they would basically be feeding off of food that the millipede has ingested, therefore kind of stealing their food. But now we kind of changed a little bit to they're more commensal, because we found by looking at them, so many of them, it doesn't appear that the nematodes are really hurting the millipede, especially when we found thousands of them in them. But what we did find is when we cross-infected them, nematodes from millipedes that had nematodes into millipedes that didn't have nematodes that we got out west. And what we did, we dissected a bunch of them, and we didn't have any nematodes in that group of millipedes. But when we put those millipedes that didn't have nematodes in with the millipedes that had nematodes, and we dissected them, we found the nematodes associated with the millipedes that have nematodes, and they ended up dying a couple weeks later. But that could be due to bacteria, it could be due to environment, stress, age. There's a lot more work that needs to be done with that. We did that for 2 years and we got fairly consistent results, but there's a lot more work we have to do on that.
Let me inject something here. The big problem is finding millipedes that don't have nematodes in them. So actually we're rearing nurses' babies now from eggs, only that isolated out from the culture so that they won't get nematodes. And eventually, how many months or years it'll take, they'll be big enough to where we can try these cross infections.
But what happened, we had like 100 babies, and as I said earlier, you know, generally less than 2 millimeters, you don't find nematodes. Dr. Bernard said, you know, just in case, you know, let's just dissect a couple. And gosh darn it, we found nematodes in ones that were like 1.5 millimeters wide. So we have to readjust our thinking now a little bit, or to get them earlier. Yes,
so when you have your Narcissus, are you rearing them from eggs?
Yeah.
And have you gotten rid of the poo? Because Narcissus females will cover them,
right,
cover their eggs in feces, I guess, to maybe transfer once they hatch out. So you're getting rid of that?
No, what we do is we put a male and female in the enclosure, and we just hope that they mate, they lay their eggs, and I've seen what the female does, and we just leave them in there.
So they, yeah, they may be getting those nematodes from the feces. They probably are.
Yeah. Yeah, because the eggs are expelled out, and then when they're feeding, they readjust the egg, and then the nematode develops.
We probably didn't get them out sooner.
Yeah.
We should have got them when they were super tiny.
Yeah. But the trick is, as you know, maybe, they're small. And when you have a container that big, and with that deep of detritus and soil, and they blend in with the dirt, and they're not moving, and you're 50 plus years old, 57, it's hard to find those darn things. Mm-hmm. I had to use our graduate student, Bob Keeper, to find them. So, yeah.
Just a curious, if people characterize the gene that controls the numbers of the RPGs.
Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't understand that.
Did people characterize the genes that control the numbers of their
numbers of
number of feet of them.
Yeah. I don't know the answer to that. I don't think so.
Oh, we've gotten that far yet.
Yes, sir.
So, do you see a correlation between the number of nematodes, nematodes, and the amount of nutrients that the millipede is eating? Like, is there a difference in like feeding weight, that kind of stuff?
You know, I haven't done that because the polydesmid millipedes don't eat the same thing as the Narcissus. They like different foods. The desert millipedes don't eat the same kind of food that I can give them here. They'll eat lettuce and stuff. But I haven't done any of the, I have so much other, so that's a great question and a great thing that for a student to do.
but we are just so far behind just trying to describe these things. But there's so many open areas for people to experiment on in this field. It's just wide open. Yes, sir.
Yeah, so I'm not looking. Are there nematodes in everything? Right? Your outreach is great, but you know, could we do that with ladybugs?
Yes.
Or whatever?
Ladybugs, grasshoppers,
roaches,
moths, just about. Nematodes are ubiquitous. They're everywhere. Beer mats, the eel worm, right? Vinegar worm.
Right
inside us. They're phoretic. They're really out. You can just go a scoop of dirt, soil. You can find hundreds of thousands, millions.
Yeah, right. We know they're in
Mark?
80% of all the animals that are alive right now are nematodes. Four out of our
bars. So you guys could pick a completely different host organism and do what we've done and find all new species. I'm 99.99% sure. So it's wide open. It's your imagination.
The weird cockroaches are running around our building.
I dissected a centipede for fun, and they're predators, but I didn't find a nematode in the centipede. But I only did it. I'm sure.
Okay, let's thank our speaker for it.
Thank you all.